You're listening to the Valley Labor Report with David Story and Jacob Morrison.
Daniel Gross is the founder and executive director of Brand Workers. Brand Workers is an organization of specialty food and manufacturing workers building an industry-wide solidarity union with the industrial workers of the world. Previously, Daniel co-founded the IWW Starbucks Workers Union and represented Brand Workers in the founding of the Food Chain Workers Alliance. Trained as an attorney, Daniel has coached and developed tools to support workers building unions and worker centers in a wide variety of industries across the country. He's the co-author with Stott and Lind of Labor Law for the Rank and Filer, and like I said, he served on the steering committee of the Labor and Employment Committee of the National Lawyers Guild, as well as on the Guild's National Executive Committee. So Daniel, I appreciate you taking the time to talk to us. I really do. I'm a big fan of your book.
It's wonderful to be with you. I only wish it was in person, and I hope that can happen soon. And I'm a fan as well, so it's a mutual admiration. Thrilled to be with you.
Thanks, Daniel. I appreciate it. So when we were talking about what we wanted to talk about, trying to get a direction for the interview, you said that you kind of wanted to talk about your book, and again, the book is just, I want to brag on the book for a second. It is a really good, and I'm showing it to the camera here, it's Labor Law for the Rank and Filer. It is, as you can see, it's short, it is very easy to read. That's something that, like, Noam Chomsky thinks is very important. Like, your work here is very digestible. I mean, anybody can just pick this book up, and after they read it, they'll have a good idea of what rights they have in the workplace, and where they can use the law as a tool in their organizing campaigns and in their direct actions. I think it's a really, really good book, really easy to read, really good synopsis of what workers can and can't do legally, quote unquote. So could you just tell us kind of what would you say is the most important thing to think about when we talk about labor law in the context of the coronavirus?
Well, first of all, let me just say I appreciate hearing how the book has resonated, because that really hits at the heart of what Stott and I were trying to get at, and which was, this was before super digital days. We wanted a book that workers could, put in their knapsack or in a pocket. We wanted it to be an affordable book, and we wanted it to be digestible, as you said. And I think the most rewarding parts of collaborating with Stotten on this work is hearing from rank and file workers from every industry you can imagine, who have found the book and have been motivated to organize with their coworkers. So it's good to hear that it's resonated over there. What a time to be talking. As you all know, working people, particularly working people of color, have been under tremendous, tremendous stress and pain long before COVID. But COVID has just escalated that and raised up so many of these issues of oppression so starkly. At Brand Workers, where I work, we've had many, many, many members sickened. Tremendous problems of physical health, mental health, and of course economic health, and we had to lay to rest one of our beloved members, Juanito, who left behind his son. So we're really talking fundamentally about survival organizing, and in particular what we've been talking about at Brand Workers and what I've been talking about in the context of labor law for the rank and filer. Is this idea that, what we really need is survival organizing that also builds power over the long term. You know, and that's my main message today, is how do we make sure we're not only surviving, but taking advantage of the opportunity to really start winning some transformative justice. So it really starts with collective action. That's what labor law for the rank and filer is all about. It's right there in this subtitle. You know, how do you build this solidarity? How do you build this power without the law getting in the way? As workers, I think so often, and it's so understandable, it's so natural, we make the mistake of thinking we can solve our problems with the law. We try to find any excuse we can. Talking to our coworkers, to avoid talking to our neighbors, to avoid talking to our folks in our faith institutions, because we just want to get to the lawyer and we hope that there's a solution there. It just doesn't work that way. The law is not built for us to solve our problems as working people that way. And what labor law for the rank and filer tries to make clear is that there is no alternative to coming together as co-workers, coming together as a working class. Once that point is clear, then we can look at the law as a sword amongst other swords. We can look at it as a shield, and we can look at how the law can be a net to restrain our solidarity. So we have to contend with the law. We have to understand how it fits in, how it doesn't fit in, but it must be a bit player in the larger story of solidarity.
Right, right. And you know, there are people on kind of either side of this argument that I think go too far. There are some that say that would say, like, you know, never use the law, never use the legalistic method or grievance procedures or anything. It doesn't build power for workers. It doesn't, like, there's no good in it. And then on the other side, you'll have business unions who say that the law and the official sanctioned pathway is the only pathway that's legitimate. And, you know, what this book does really well is it helps workers understand what their options are. And I think that, I think that it's important to assess every tool that workers have in their toolkit and use every tool that they can to the extent that it helps. And, you know, sometimes a grievance procedure in a business union is especially in a business union that's kind of been weakened and beaten down. You know, I mean, that may be the best thing that you can get. And to just wholesale say that's not an option, that doesn't make sense. Or to say that the NLRB, going to the NLRB, is just not an option, I mean, it doesn't make sense. Now, is that always the best option? No, of course not. But it's important to, like, dispassionately assess what the tools that you have, and this book really helps to do that.
Yes, absolutely. I agree with you 100%. What I try to get at working with folks organizing in a variety of industries is that when it comes time to identify and go after a deeply held problem, whether it's the boss not allowing adequate mourning for coworkers who have been felled to the boss's negligence in COVID, whether it's a lack of health care, whether it's wage theft, whether it's sexual harassment, whatever the issue is, you've got to start with understanding that you have to build enough power to overcome the boss's resistance to your demand and win it.
Right.
That's the starting point.
Right.
Not where do I file my OSHA complaint? Where do I file my EEOC complaint? It's about asserting enough power.
Right. We're speaking to Daniel Gross. We're going to talk to him some more on the other side of this break about how you can use the law to help win in your workplace, and how sometimes maybe it's not the best thing to look towards. So stay tuned. This is the Valley Labor Report. We're talking to Daniel Gross.
You're listening to the Valley Labor Report with David Story and Jacob Morrison.
you want higher wages, let me tell you what to do. Got to talk to the workers in the shop with you. You got to build you a union, got to make it strong. But if you all stick together, boys, won't be long. You got shorter hours.
Shorter hours.
Better working conditions.
Better working conditions.
Vacations with pay.
That's
take your kids to the seashore.
Take them there.
Of course, it ain't quite that simple, so I better explain just why you got to ride on the union train. Because if you wait for the boss to raise your pay, we'll all be waiting till Judgment Day. We'll all be buried. Gone to heaven. St. Peter will be the straw boss then, boys. Now you know you're underpaid, but the boss...
All right. Welcome back to the Valley Labor Report. We are talking to Daniel Gross, co-author of Labor Law for the Rank and Filer, about labor law in the context of the coronavirus pandemic. So we've kind of been talking about strategies and how labor law maybe can and can't help in the abstract. But Daniel, can you talk to us about specifically some of the rights that workers have that are codified that they could theoretically go to the NLRB or to OSHA and file a complaint? And can you kind of tell us what those rights are and what the mechanisms for enforcement are, and how you can incorporate this into a broader strategy of building democratic worker power within a union of working people working in solidarity with one another?
Yes, now that I've hopefully talked us out of looking to the law as the first solution, you've come together with your coworkers. You understand that you're going to have to build an organization together. You are looking at the set of tools you're going to use to assert the power you're going to need to win. So let's start with the most profound law of all, a very unique law, and that's the National Labor Relations Act. It is so unique because it doesn't speak to our protection as an individual worker, and it doesn't speak to a particular working condition or wage that we don't like and we want to change. It protects the right for us to come together with our coworkers and fight our boss around whatever wage or working condition issue we want to fight on. That could be social distancing policies, masks, sanitizers, paid sick leave, or it could be, and I'm going to use an example to provoke a little bit, it could be we don't like the coffee in the break room that's being provided. My point here is that if you find yourself with your coworkers frustrated or hurt or upset about any wage or working condition that you're facing, you have the right to take action against it. You don't have to look up the law and see, well, you know, we want to get paid a night differential for the night shift. Are we able to come together and demand the boss and fight the boss to get that? Yes, you can. So the same is true for safety, not just COVID, any safety issue you could imagine. Are the machines in good working order? Are they being operated correctly? Is there the right training? So I want to tell you some good news, because I'm usually bearing bad news about labor law. The National Labor Relations Act, which protects you across the country, it protects striking. But the highest protected strike in labor law in the United States is about abnormally dangerous conditions. Conditions that I would argue, employers would argue the contrary, that include dying from the boss's recklessness with respect to an infectious disease that can kill you. It's so protected that the National Labor Relations Act doesn't even consider a work stoppage around abnormally dangerous conditions a strike. It says, this is such a sacred thing to stop work to protect your life, that it's not even a strike. So I think that's where I would definitely start. You know, sisters, brothers, fellow workers of all genders, please do not leave it up to your boss to protect your life. I cannot tell you the heartbreak to lay a fellow worker to rest from COVID and see the look on their child's face. Please do not leave it up to the boss to get you through this pandemic. That is a right that you have.
And
Jacob, you mentioned OSHA. There's a very analog right. There's a very relevant right in the OSHA Act. That's the Occupational Safety and Health Act. That's also a law around the nation. And that's the right to refuse dangerous work. The exact steps to take and look at, you can find at OSHA.gov. But the bottom line is pretty simple. If there's work that's dangerous, and you can't get out of that danger in another way, the harm is imminent, you have the protected right not to do that work. I'm going to sound like a broken record. You want to do that with your coworkers.
Yeah.
You want to do it with the labor union. You want to do it as part of a larger strategy.
That's
dangerous work.
That's what I was about to mention, is to bring it back towards your initial statement, is you need to be working collectively. This doesn't work if you as an individual go out and try to do this by yourself.
Amen. Amen. I think that's the key point, and I think that's the hardest part of COVID organizing. As workers started organizing, many of us started having conversations, giving trainings around this major challenge. How do you organize for survival while building long-term union power? That is the question that everyone has to grapple with. And I think the answer to that is, as fast as things are moving, as hard as things are right now, economically, physical health, mental health, we still have to try to stick to the organizing fundamentals as much as possible. So it's not about just, you know, going willy-nilly without a game plan and going after the boss. It's about figuring out how are we going to go after the boss to stay safe today while laying the groundwork for power tomorrow. And those are some of the boring things that maybe you want to talk about in such a fast-moving time of history. It's how do we get a hold of an organizing training so we can learn how to make what organizers...
Right. That's exactly right. It's important to do everything in the context of building power for yourself and your fellow workers. We're going to be talking to Daniel Gross about this for one more segment. Daniel, thanks again for your time. Folks, stay tuned. This is the Valley Labor Report. Folks, good morning and welcome back to the Valley Labor Report. We have Daniel Gross on the line. We're talking about labor law in the context of the coronavirus and in the context of using the law as a tool to build power in your union. Daniel was talking about how the NLRA and OSHA protect your right to strike, and more than that, it protects your right to do a work stoppage over unsafe working conditions, and that's one of the highest, most protected rights that you have. And so this is an important tool to incorporate into your organizing plan to build solidarity among your coworkers and to keep yourself and your sisters and brothers on the job safe. Like Daniel said, he's had to bury a fellow worker because of this. And I mean, I couldn't imagine. I know people, I've got family members who lost both of their parents to this. And that's really tough. And so it's important where we can to be fighting for each other, because the boss isn't going to do it for you. The politicians left town. They're on vacation right now. They're not in D.C. They're not fighting for you. You've got to fight for yourselves. And so that's why we're having this conversation, to figure out what kind of tools we have in our toolbox. And so, Daniel, you talked about how these rights are protected. How does a worker go about enforcing these rights that they have technically protected, right? Because we know that in America, the boss, and especially if you work for a large corporation, they have so much more power, and they will tell you, they'll just lie to you about the rights that you have. And so you need to be firm in what you know, and you need to be firm in the process for getting these rights enforced, because your boss isn't going to help you enforce your right to strike over unsafe working conditions. That's not going to work. So, And there are people that are fired illegally for organizing. So what do workers do to enforce these rights that they have? How do they go about that?
Well, in the most narrow sense, to enforce both your rights with the NLRB and OSHA, it's a very simple process to file a complaint. Very simple form. Go to nlrb.gov, osha.gov. To actually win and build power and have the job you deserve every day, unions are essential. There is no substitute for unions, for workers that want to have the job they and their family deserve, over the long haul. And the more clear we can get on that, the better our workplaces will get, but also our society. When you look at, the economic pain that folks are experiencing because of government's absence to get us through this pandemic economically. Why is that? When we look at the environmental issues, why are all these things happening? It's because, in part, we don't have enough power as organized workers, and that comes from unions. I should say, in terms of supporting unions, which should be at the center, there's also other groups that folks can look to, worker centers, advocacy groups, community groups, networks of workers in your industry, that can also play a really helpful supporting role, while you're forming your labor union.
Right. Yeah, there's one in Alabama that does some really good work. Adelante Alabama Workers Center down in Birmingham. I don't think we have a worker center in Huntsville, but Adelante is really good. I've been to an organizer training there, and I was really impressed with the folks that are staffing it, at least, and the grounding that they have in their community. You mentioned that, we talked about kind of the legal process. What would be some of your advice for building solidarity among your coworkers? Because like you mentioned, filing a complaint with the NLRB, filing a complaint with OSHA, that will work kind of narrowly in certain instances. But the broadest and best and most powerful weapon that you have is the labor of yourself and your fellow workers, and the ability to withhold that labor. So how would you go about building solidarity among your coworkers in the process of building up to a strike, or building up to a work stoppage, or building up to a petition, or some other action?
As simplistic as it sounds, it starts with the conversation. And I never take for granted how scary or weird it can be to try to set up a conversation with your coworker after work, not to talk sports, not to talk relationships, not to just have a beverage, but actually to talk about work. I think back to when I was a barista at Starbucks, and it came time to start seeing if my coworkers wanted to come together and start a union. I always keep present in my mind, I was extremely nervous that first time. It was, the day had come, and I had to look at my coworker on the shop floor and say, hey, can we meet later this week to talk about work? I was really scared. I was nervous. But I got through it, and we did meet, and we had a wonderful meeting. And the second time I had to do it, it got a little easier. And the third time it got easier. And then it became like natural and nothing at all. So I honor it can be hard. But have a conversation with your coworker. Do it one-on-one so you can really connect and see what's going on, what their problems are, what their aspirations are for the future. Just listen. Oh, my goodness. If I said one piece of advice, just listen.
Right.
So much good will happen if you listen to each other as coworkers. And ultimately, you're going to want to get support. It's very, very difficult to go it alone. You'll be able to kind of explore out there what fits. If you're looking for something that's member led, member operated, big vision for social change, you'll go IWW. If you're looking for a union that is maybe more about reform, more so than fundamental change, where you can participate and you can vote on the union's work, but much is done by staff and elected representatives, certainly if you want a traditional collective bargaining agreement, you'll go with one of the AFL-CIO unions. And if you're really, really, really stubborn and you absolutely cannot find any union that you connect with, you'll start an independent union with
right.
no affiliation. That's really difficult. Please try to find a union to work with. But sometimes folks go independent, and in rare cases, they're successful.
It takes it, but to speak to that for just a second, it is very, very difficult for somebody to do that. And then if you reach out, part of that collectivism that we talk about, that you're talking about in work, also extends out to your brothers and sisters across the nation and in other nations, and the fact that you can build that solidarity with other people in your industry, whether it be with IWW or your typical AFL-CIO union or trade union or industrial union. But there's also a lot of education there. People that's been there and done that numerous times before that can help guide you as a worker along that path without having, because there's going to be a lot of mistakes,
Right.
And so definitely, I can't even imagine trying to do that by myself.
Right. Yeah. So we have a few more minutes left in this segment, and I got somebody asked me a question. Is this an unsafe working environment? And I think that in the context of the coronavirus. And so how do my thing would probably be that if everybody working there says it's an unsafe working environment and they're willing to take an action about it, sign a petition or do a work stoppage or a work slowdown, then it's an unsafe working environment. But how do you delineate between a safe and unsafe working environment in the context of the coronavirus?
I think you hit it right on the head. Workers are the experts on work, and if we listen to workers, then we'll have a lot of clarity on what's safe and what's not. And you see that now with the reopening of public schools, where teachers were not consulted, and in some cases, teachers are beating back that opening with strikes or threats of strikes. The bottom line is that, this virus is extremely contagious, and there's some workplaces that just cannot be safe right now, by virtue of the kind of work that they're doing.
Yeah. Daniel, that's exactly right. And so the big thing to take away from this conversation is the most powerful tool that you have is yourself and your fellow workers. But Daniel, we've got about 15 seconds left. Tell us where we can find you and where we can buy your book.
You can find me on Twitter at DG Organized. You can find Brand Workers at brandworkers.org. And the best place to buy the book is
from the Valley Labor Report with David Story and Jacob Morrison.
We just got through with a conversation with Daniel Gross, and we cut it just a little bit too close. We were just a bit too close. And he was telling us where we could buy his book. But the best place to buy his book is PMPress.org. That is a printing collective worker. It's a worker cooperative. So That's some good. It's good. That's where I got mine from. That's labor law for the rank and filer, building solidarity while staying clear of the law. So,
and one of the things to point out when you're ordering from them is recognize that your money is going to the workers.
Right.
Don't go out and buy this book on Amazon. You send the money to the workers.
Thanks for tuning in. We appreciate your time. If you want to see what we're up to throughout the week and get our snide quips about the news of the day, then you should follow us on social media. We're on Facebook at facebook.com/Valley Labor Report. We're on Twitter at Labor Reporters. I'm on Twitter at JacobM_AL. David is on Twitter at Radical Unionist. That's spelled RADICL Unionist. If you missed part of the show and want to go back and watch it later, search YouTube for The Valley Labor Report and subscribe to our channel. You can go back and watch the full show there, and we also clip segments throughout the week. And we also upload the program on more than 11 different podcasting apps. So you can see if we're on your listening platform of choice. You can go to thevalleylaborreport.transistor.fm/subscribe. And if you appreciate our work and want to help us stay on the air, then consider throwing us a couple dollars a month on patreon.com/thevalleylaborreport.